This morning we're going to continue in the series Learning to Lose. And today we're going to be talking about our treasure, surrendering our treasure. Revelation chapter 4, verse 10. There's fourth day of the month in the sixth month in the second year of Darius the king. He gives this date line again. And we got the date of when it happened. Really important. First thing I want to say, I want to point out that part says, and they came and worked on the house of the Lord of hosts, their God. They came and worked on the house. Wonderful. The message got through. The people were inspired. And God began to use them again to build his house. We don't work on physical structures. This is not, when we say we're in the house of the Lord, I get the idea because it's a place of localized community worship. But listen, the house of the Lord, if you're talking what it really is, it's sitting right here in these seats. If you are a believer, a follower of Jesus, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. You are the temple of God. And we will put ourselves in a way where we can be a part of building up the body of Christ, the temple of God, then it's going to be a wonderful work that the Lord is going to bless and he wants us to be a part of. Why not? Why not let this inspire you to do what you know you ought to be doing in your home, in your job, in your own life? Lord, if you're calling me, that must mean you're going to help me. And if you help me, how can I fail? So I'm just going to do the right thing. When? Right now, because this is a time to do it. I think it's awesome. If you look at those, if you look at the timeline, all the way at the beginning of what we started reading, first of the month, we see that down on the 24th day of the month, the people started to work. That means that within 23 days, the people heard the word, gathered the materials, got organized, and continued the work that they had begun 16 years ago. Again, Haggai is a prophet. What a blessing when the people listen and they respond. What a blessing when they take those good intentions and couple it with action. And we see that in 23 days, it started. So I would challenge you with this. If you're taking notes this morning, there are many of you who have been, you know, the Proverbs a day, keep stupid away thing. You guys have been doing that, and you share those verses with me. I love that. Hey, feel free. Email me those messages you get or give me those insights that God is revealing to you. I love it. It's encouraging when I see that happening. But a proverb a day, today is, what is today? The 8th? The 8th chapter of Proverbs. Tomorrow would be the 9th? 9th chapter of Proverbs. I take and I pull a little snippet of truth out of that. The one I did, I think it was for today or yesterday. Anyway, has to do with wisdom. I just write a little short thing about wisdom, the truth of it. People who are wise understand how to submit to authority and be taught. But if you're not teachable, that means you're so cocky and you're foolish that you're going to pay a price for it. So I wrote down the observation, then I wrote down how I can apply that to my life in a prayer. Lord, help me not to be a fool. Help me to have a teachable spirit so that I can always learn, because I don't want to be the fool. I need to be in the right. And that means I need to learn how to submit to the teaching of Scripture, to submit to the teaching of the other members in the body of Christ. I need to be moldable so that the Lord can work with me. That's it. That's my little devotion for the day. It's a short little paragraph. If you're not doing that, put it in motion. We talk about wanting God's Word to become powerful in our lives, to come alive in us. Do something about it. Take and start doing that simple daily devotion. You might do that with your spouse, with your kids, whoever. But take and do that devotion time. Put it, the desire or what do I call that? The good intention. Take that good intention, couple it with action. I would challenge you. Take and do a morning devotion or a nightly devotion, a short little devotion like what I described to you now. Some of you may say, man, I go way beyond that. Praise the Lord. Good job. But I'm talking to those who maybe you need to get something jump-started again. You don't start building the roof before you put up the walls. Get something started. Get something started. That's a good, simple way to get it going. And I end with this. How can you gauge your maturity? I have these cards over here that help people find out how mature they are as a Christian. And I encourage you, come up here. They're free. Come grab one and take it. And you can kind of get a temperature reading on your faith and your walk with God. How can I know? How can I know if I'm maturing as a Christian? How can I know if I'm really treating my treasure right? What's the greatest treasure in your life? The people around you. How can I know if I'm maturing as a Christian so that God can trust me to do what's right with my treasure? I ask this question, and this is huge. Can you dream for anybody other than yourself? A practical way to look at this. Can I dream for my son? Can I dream for him and see something in his future and spend my energy trying to make that dream a reality? Can I dream for, as a pastor, for the staff, for the other young men and women coming up in this, can I dream for them and spend myself helping them succeed? Or do I focus on what I need to do to expand myself so that I can be a better minister? That's huge today. And we spend so much time talking about what God is doing in us and what we see God calling us to do. And you think about it a lot. But I'm telling you what the Lord has done in my life as we prepared this. And I think this question is straight from him before any other questions I've asked. Is, can you dream for someone else? And can you take that good intention and put some action behind it? Because honestly, it's hard to dream for somebody else when all you're thinking about is you. I want to be the kind of Christian who can dream for others and sacrifice myself to see them succeed. I'm not quite there yet, but I'm working toward that goal. Because here's the reality. When they succeed, I succeed. When my kids succeed, I succeed. Because I will be in a wheelchair, toothless and laid up, and they're going to be taking care of me, right? It's coming, so we better invest and plant good seed, because one day it's going to come back and we're going to have to eat whatever it is that we've planted. And the pastor I was under before, he used to say, man, if you want to make a good investment, invest in old folks' homes. Because so many people have thrown their kids in daycare, that's all they've ever known, while they pursue the career. When the time comes around, they're going to be thrown into the old folks' home while their kids are out doing the exact same thing they did. Right? I say invest in hearing aids because Casey's going to... I'm just joking. I'm just joking. Kind of. Anyway, now I got off track. What are you going to build with the time that God has given you? Think about this. We all have just a measure of time. It goes by so quickly. It's here and gone. What are you going to build during the time that God has given you? Why not start building something of value today, something eternal, the treasure that God's given you? Work with it. How about getting into God's word with your family with a regular devotion and prayer time? Good start. The greatest treasure that we have to work with on this earth are the people that God has placed in our lives. Let's do all we can to not only passionately know Jesus, but also help to make Jesus known by those around us. It's a high call, huge challenge. If you want to lose something, I can't wait to get there and just drop off my kids at the feet of Jesus. As a parent with young kids, that means something to me. I can't wait to take that, would be my crown, this point in my life, and wow, there it is. Lord, my treasure. I did the best I could. I did the best I could to make them know you. God, my church family. We're all here. I hope you're there, right, when that day comes? We're all here. Both services. And some of you who come to the first service are going to look at people from the second service and be like, you're here too? I never knew you were a part of it. Yeah, we all were. And we stand there before God and I say, Lord, you called me. You called me to be a pastor in a community. And I did the best I could. I did the best I could to help them know you so that they would be passionate to follow you. And Lord, here we are. This is it. I mean, who cares about throwing pavement at his feet? People are eternal. You, my friend, are a treasure. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes this morning. None of this matters if you don't know Jesus as boss and Lord of your life. Really, none of it matters. Unless you have come to a place where you can surrender yourself and say, Jesus, I'm yours. Sin entered and divided. And believe me, if you're not in Jesus, there is a huge division between you and God. And there are no good promises that you have to look forward to except for judgment and an eternity separated from God in a hell that never goes out. That's the brutal truth. But God loves you so much. He loves you so much that he wants to save you from that future. And he loves you so much that not only does he want to save you, he wants to give you a reason to live and look forward to tomorrow. And if I were here right now and I didn't know Jesus like that, this is exactly prayer with me. Jesus, I need you. I don't want to ever be separated from you, ever. Not in this life, nor the life to come. So I surrender my life to you. You are God. You are not dead on a cross. You're not buried in some tomb. You're alive and you are watching me right now. And you are a king that is going to come back. And when you come back, I want you to find me living for you, worshiping you, starting from today for the rest of my life in this existence. Lord, when you come back, I don't want you to come find me with just a bunch of good intentions. I want you to find me with good intentions coupled with action, working with the best treasure that we have here, the people that you've given me in my life. So Lord, to make all this happen, it can only happen with you. So I give you my life, my heart, everything I am is yours. Take my life, Lord. Teach me how to live for you. Forgive me for all the junk that I've done in the past, and let me have a fresh start in working for you. Forgive me for the times that I didn't do what I know you were calling me to. I'm ready to work today. I'm ready to get on it, just like those people did in the scriptures we read earlier. Lord, I'm yours. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, I'm telling you, do something about it. Tonight, we're going to be talking in the 201 growth track, talking about the things that good Christian folks should be practicing to grow in their faith. Well, I don't know what to do. Well, come so that we can discover that together. Do you know somebody who doesn't know what they need to know as they've begun walking with Christ? This class is designed, this environment is designed to help somebody practice the important things to grow in their Christian faith. Amen.